Welcome, everyone. Sound check in Imperial. Do you guys hear us?
I'm clear.
Can you sign?
Imperial County, can you hear us?
Yes, we can. Loud and clear.
Oh, thank you. We're going to start this meeting just a few minutes late. This is our regularly scheduled Energy Consumers Advisory Committee meeting for Imperial Irrigation District. Today is September 12, 2011. We're going to start with call to order and roll call, please.
Mr. Ortega?
Present.
Mr. Abadi? Mr. Anderson? Mr. McFadden? Mr. Alsup? Mr. Nunez?
Present.
I don't think so either. Mr. Perez?
Present.
Mr. Zendejas?
Present.
Ms. Thomas? Ms. Gomez?
Present.
Mr. Blum? Ms. Franklin? Mr. McNicky?
Present.
Mr. Aviles?
Present.
Mr. Ramos? Ms. Ramos-Watson?
Present.
Ms. Broughton?
Present.
Ms. Saleh?
Present.
And Mr. Bayard?
Present.
Thank you.
For the record, will you tally how many members are present or which ones are absent, just so we know?
Yes, and I also have someone there who's taking an extra count.
Madam Chairman, would you please speak a little louder?
For our information on both sides, I asked Marion to please let us know which members were absent, just so we know.
Sure. I've got right now Mr. Anderson, Mr. McFadden, Mr. Alsup, and Ms. Thomas.
Mr. McFadden, are you in the room?
Yes, I am.
Yes, I am.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, so who is absent?
Mr. Anderson, Mr. Alsup, and Ms. Thomas.
Mr. Alsup, Mr. Anderson, and Ms. Thomas. Thank you, everyone. It's going to go a little slow here in the beginning. All right, if everyone would please stand, we're going to pledge allegiance at this time. Ready? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Item number two in our agenda is the approval of the minutes for August 1st, 2011. Are there any corrections, revisions, or additions to the minutes as presented? Hearing no changes, I will entertain a motion.
So moved.
That two people.
I have a motion from Mr. Blum and a second from Ms. Broughton. Is there any further discussion on the minutes? All those in favor?
Aye.
Are there any opposed? Are there any opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you.
I abstain. I wasn't present.
We have one abstention from Mr. Aviles. Thank you. Item number three, public comment period. Imperial, you will have to let me know if anyone comes forward that wants to speak. This is a time set aside for any member of the audience wishing to address the body to please make themselves known. If they would come up to the podium and state their name, we would be happy to hear from them at this time. We see no one step forward in the La Quinta location. Is there anyone in Imperial? Seeing no one and hear no one come forward, we will close the public comment period and move on to item number four. We will have a brief presentation from Ms. Champion on the ground rules for video conferencing equipment.
Good evening, everyone. As stated, my name is Marion Champion. I'm the ECAC coordinator. I am just here to kind of remind everyone about the microphones and kind of how they work. They are very sensitive, so you'll probably want to keep your microphones in the off position unless you are engaged in a conversation or you're the chairperson. I would also ask that Mr. Ortega there in Imperial, if you could help us, if someone's microphone is not on, if you could help remind them to turn theirs on. Chairwoman Ramos Watson will do the same in La Quinta so that we can try to make sure everybody is heard equally. Does anyone have any questions?
Is this system speaker sensitive so that when we speak, the camera focuses on the person that's speaking?
Yes, absolutely. And that's why we probably want to leave our microphones in the off position. They will pick up if you're just wrestling paper and you're in the on position, the camera will move over to you. And if you're whispering to your neighbor, it will zoom in on you.
Marianne, this is Gil Perez. Would you have all the members speak into the microphone so we can hear them better?
Yes, I'll remind everyone. Thank you, Gil.
Marion, I don't know. They're seeing me right now. We're obviously not seeing me on the cameras.
Correct.
Okay.
Are there any other questions from Imperial? Hearing none? Thank you very much, Ms. Champion. Moving on to item number 5, we have an introduction of the Interim Energy Manager, Mr. Joel Ivey, by Mr. Kelly.
Madam Chairman, members of the ECAC, Mr. Ivey is here, and I'll just present him to you. Joel, you might come on up and field 20 questions.
Well, welcome, Mr. Ivey. You're a new face to us, so please feel free to give us your whole history and where you were born and everything.
Where I was born. Be careful. I've got a microphone. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Appreciate the opportunity to be here, even in this capacity. Joel Ivey just started with the district in January. And I came by way of New Mexico, by way of Texas. I'm a little bit well-traveled. You might be able to detect that. I'm a little bit well-traveled in the business. I've been in the electric utility business now for some 20, probably 7 years. I'm starting to quit counting because it's getting to be too much to worry about. But I have been in electrical operations for my entire career. I started in this business as a lineman many, many, many years ago, thousands of years ago. I went the whole night school routine, tried to work my way through, and had very good support for the communities, my family, and the companies that I worked for at the time, so I was able to complete a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering. So just had a nice opportunity with the position that came open out here. My wife and I are relatively nomadic, and we're willing to move if the opportunities come along. They're right for us, and this was right for us. So we're living in El Centro now, and both my wife and I are just really happy to be here. We would hope it would be maybe 82 degrees instead of 115, but we're learning to cope and to deal with that. So I'd be happy to take any questions anybody might have.
Well, first of all, welcome. Does anyone on this committee have any questions for Mr. Ivey? Okay, there are none here in La Quinta. Does Imperial County have any questions for our new energy manager, Mr. Joel Ivey? No one.
Hello? I'm sure we'll make up for that.
Yeah, we will. This is just the first time we've met you.
We're being nice.
Oh, thanks. There will be plenty of opportunities in the future. Madam Chairwoman, if I may, I have just another second. We have with us also Angela Evans. She is the assistant manager for the La Quinta area. She had just started with us a month ago, if something like that. Angela is our go-to person for any of the activities that we have in La Quinta. She's on duty, lives here. Her husband is just moving in as we speak, I think. So for any issues that come up locally here, she is your person.
Wonderful. Welcome. Thank you very much, Mr. Ivey. Okay, moving on to our next item, item number six, regulatory compliance update. Mr. Kelly?
Madam Chairman, members of the ECAC, this item was prompted by a request from one of your members. It has to do with the regulatory hurdles that IID faces. I have a timeline here with me. I don't believe that regulatory compliance has come up before ECAC previously. But suffice it to say that as an energy balancing authority, the district has something like 1,200 standards that it has to adhere to. These range from simple record keeping to very sophisticated critical assets that we have to account for. And this whole regimen is about reliability. So the bodies that we have to appear before and satisfy range from the Western Electricity Coordinating Council to the North American Energy Regulatory Corporation to the Federal Energy Regulatory Corporation. Just as an aside, the outage that we experienced last week in which our system was down and then thankfully restored. Just today, we were contacted by FERC, and they want all of our records related to that event, and they want them by Friday of this week. So with that, I do have a timeline because compliance didn't just begin, within the last 4 years that IID. We were always doing it. Reliability is certainly the watchword at a public utility. But it became a top of mind during the time that Director Abadi was on the board. And we frankly struggled with it for a couple of years and then made really good headway most recently when we did an audit or had an audit performed across a range of standards and it performed very well. This was in the news just recently. A privilege report.
Mr. Kelly, I'm sorry to interrupt you. Marion? The audio feed is a little bit distorted. I'm not sure if Mr. Kelly, you can speak a little bit louder and into the microphone, and we'll see if that corrects the problem.
And I'm sure that
is it dragging? Is it lagging? What do you mean distorted?
Yes, it's I believe it's dragging. That might be the word.
Yeah, because that's how you sounded in the beginning, dragging. But now you are clear, so.
The other two microphones.
I'll try it again.
Let's
see if it makes
sense. We're being told that maybe the other two microphones that are, they're causing feedback, the microphones right next to the podium.
Make sure they're off.
Yeah. These were off, so I just turned this one off on to speak to you, but they were off originally.
Okay, he'll speak up, I'm sure.
We all have our microphones off except for Mr. Kelly.
Okay, so what I was gonna say is that in December, IID performed remarkably well in a comprehensive audit for compliance. Just recently, in an unfortunate release of a confidential document that appeared in the local newspaper, our critical infrastructure assets program, which is a variation of the compliance that we that we have instituted. It became fodder for a public discussion, and I won't speak to that in case any of you want to ask about it. It's a matter of potential fines, and we have formed an internal task force among many different disciplines at the district to address whatever deficiencies might exist in that area. But I do want to report to you that compliance is not only an ongoing concern of the district, but has become an organizational imperative. We want to inculcate or instill a culture of compliance in which we go beyond simple record keeping, and we prove up our reliability across the enterprise. And with that, I'll take any questions that you might have. Yes, sir.
Kevin, did you say you're not going to go into it? Because it obviously brings up questions in my mind. Was this a whistleblower event? I mean, were we not in compliance and someone leaked information? Was that person in a position of confidence and misused their position, and has it been addressed?
No, it wasn't. It wasn't an instance of whistleblowing. It was a proprietary report, a privileged and confidential report that was discussed in closed session. And as you know, those of you involved in municipal government, you know, that is by its nature privileged, and so it has to do with how we intend to prove up our regulatory compliance in the area of critical assets. And critical assets, we're talking about the emergency, the energy system, how we communicate the hardware in a situation like we had last week. And we have to produce those records after the fact routinely to demonstrate our compliance. But we have to do it in real time so that we know as an organization that we're doing all we're supposed to be doing. So
may I go a step further? As a result of that information being made public, are you saying that IID is going to be fined for the information that was in that report?
No, I really shouldn't characterize it beyond these are very specialized and sophisticated computer systems that are separate from the regular IID, because they have to be. They are those that we rely on to keep the system talking to each other, to itself, and to keep the lights on. And because they are critical assets, they are covered under Homeland Security. So there was an extra layer of confidentiality that was breached. And whether or not the district faces fines, that would be a matter between it and the regulatory body until they're published, if there were such a thing.
Mr. Lee, how were the records put into the hands of the newspaper? Was it the Imperial Valley newspaper or the Desert Sun?
It was the Imperial Valley Press.
Okay.
It could have been any newspaper. Newspapers live off of leaked documents. But this really wasn't a sinister leak of a document. It was shared in closed session with members of staff and the board, and it was just an unfortunate incident.
Do we have any questions in Imperial County? Okay, Mr. Abadi's going to speak, and then if you'll let me know if any Imperial members would ask any questions.
Thank you, Chairman, Chairwoman Ramos. Mr. Kelly, first of all, I'd like to congratulate you and commend you and your staff and for the power outage on their expertise and expediting their experience with excellence. It's fantastic. Good people there. I guess on the reliability, is what's confidential, is that the audit itself or the report from the IntelliBind?
Well, I think all of these are eventually public documents. I believe the reason that this falls under the privilege is that we still have an outstanding, unsettled matter with the regulatory agencies.
Okay, well, leave that alone. I understand that, appreciate that. But as soon as can get cleaned up, that we can get a look at, understand a little bit more about what's going on with the compliance and reliability and SIPs and stuff.
Yes, certainly. That document that's already been generally reported, we'll make available to you when it's. We will include the ECAC on this very important area of the district's operations.
And on top of that, Mr. Kelly, I realize now how important this is and the difference between out of power for 2 or 3 hours versus 12 to 24 and the IED's footprint and how important the reliability standards are in FERC's eyes and maintaining our balance authority. I would support you and any resources you need to throw toward this effort. Thank you.
Do any Imperial County members wish to ask any questions? Mr. Blum?
Mr. Kelly, I have a question on the previous item, number 5, if I may. It says that Mr. Ivey is an interim. Is that typically you hire interim then to permanent, or is it truly an interim position?
Well, it's interim, and we'll post the position, and we'll recruit for it.
Okay, so you are still recruiting for the position?
We've not launched a recruitment, but it's our intention to do so, yes.
And what's the time frame?
Imminent.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly, on the update. If there be no further questions, we're going to move on to our next item, which is purchasing / request for proposal overview by Ms. Laurie Franks. And we do have a paper copy of the presentation in our packets as well.
Good evening, and thank you for inviting me to present an overview on how IED does contracts. My name is Laurie Franks, and I am the contract administrator for the Imperial Irrigation District. Can everyone hear me okay? All right. One of my responsibilities to oversee the solicitation process and to ensure that each award is handled ethically and efficiently, resulting in the best value for the district. Every proposal is posted through our website and is driven in that manner. Each vendor proposal is evaluated through an evaluation criteria that is also posted on that site. The evaluation covers several different areas, including but not limited to price, quality, schedule, services, local vendor, and other factors that are crucial to the successful completion of the project. One question I get a lot is, who is classified as a local vendor? According to IED Policy 3109, which was adopted in December 2009, provides 5 points out of 100 in the evaluation process. Local vendor is a vendor located in the service area of IED who maintains a full permanent business in their company name and have established an electrical power or an irrigation water account with IED in their company name. Another question I was asked was, do we provide preference for minorities? We provide preference for all of our local vendors. And also, according to California Prop 209, which was approved in 1996, an amendment to the state constitution prohibiting public institutions from considering race, sex, or ethnicity. Here I've presented two pie charts. The first chart is our general, all of our contracts, and I'm talking purchase orders, service agreements, everything that we do business, and is separated by local versus non. As you can tell, it's 33% local, 67% non-local. Then I split it into the combined with excluding major projects issued between 2002 and 2011, which gives us 60-40 percentage. Reason why you're probably wondering why I did that is, in addition to this chart, which breaks down per year from 2002 to 2011, you can see our average percentages are 67 to 60%. Most of our major projects that are outlined here are, again, non-vendors, non-local vendors. However, we encourage them to hire local subcontractors. Always strongly encourage that. Some of our local contractors are not equipped to complete the project on their own, and I encourage them to attend our mandatory meetings and our job walks in order to partner up with other companies.
Lori?
Complete.
I'm sorry to interrupt. We are experiencing the same audio difficulties as...
The dragging?
Yeah, the dragging. So, I don't know if we... Yeah, okay. Can we try it again? Let's just see what happens now.
Okay, would you like me to try from there. This slide or from the
previous? It's clear now. We can hear you loud and clear.
Okay. Okay. What I was talking about is on this chart is the percentages are broken down by year and highlighting some different types of major multi-million dollar projects. One thing that's very important to note on this chart is that it does not reflect the number of subcontractors that are local. The 60 to 67% of the non-local vendors includes contracts where the vendor has hired local vendors as subcontractors. We strongly encourage our local vendors that are not equipped to complete a project on their own to attend our mandatory meetings and job walks to partner up with other vendors in order to participate in the project. Therefore, when we are evaluating the non-local vendors, though they do not receive the 5-point preference, since they are not local, they could obtain points in other categories such as experience, geographical limitations, knowledge and understanding of our local environment and community, and by hiring local vendors as their subcontractors. Another question I was asked is regarding recruiting local vendors. How do we get out there? We continue to outreach for our local vendors through vendor showcases, public events, workshops, and participate whenever asked as a presenter or a panel member to get the word out on how to do business with IID. The latest event that I attended was last month on August 26th, titled Doing Business with the Government. It was presented by Assemblyman Perez, the Business and Entrepreneurship Center, and the Imperial Valley Small Business Development Center. There were approximately 65 local vendors in attendance, and I have brought the brochures that I hand out at all of my events and also my business cards for you to pick up if you would like them. At this point, I would like to thank you again for inviting me and open it up to whatever questions you have on this topic.
Thank you very much, and I just want to be clear on the presentation. The percentages you're giving and sharing with us today are percentages of contracts, not percentages of dollar of the contract.
Correct.
Just to be so that we're all on the same page. Does anyone in La Quinta have any questions for Ms. Franks?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead, Mr. Blum.
When you had 65 vendors turn out for that forum that you held that Mr. Perez handled, was that a good turnout, an average turnout, or a poor turnout on the part of vendors for?
I was not the coordinator of it. It was the coordination of another agency, which was the Business and Entrepreneurship Center and the SBDC, the Small Business Development Center. So I was asked to attend as a panel member
to present how to do business with government. I think 65 members, I believe that they intended to have approximately 100 people.
Where was it held?
It was at the CalWorks on 4th. Okay. In El Centro.
Just for my own personal information, do the municipalities and utilities here in the Valley do a lot of those meet and greet type events?
Well, I'm a member of the Chamber of Commerce, and I also attend the Business Showcase in Imperial Valley every year. I attend the fair. We have IID has a booth, and I attend at the booth. I know a couple of years ago there was out here in La Quinta, there was a business showcase that I also attended and had a booth. Whenever I'm invited, I attend. In addition to talking at our job sites, meeting vendors on the street, that's basically how we promote doing business with us.
Is it sponsored by usually, excuse me, one of the assemblymen, or is it... Is it sponsored by other companies or private enterprise as well?
Well, another one that I attended was put on through the county, and a lot of the CalWorks programs and like the Economic Development Center, they'll do things to try to bring in small businesses and big businesses to the Valley. And they'll invite me to attend in order to explain how they can do business with IID. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a couple of more requests to speak, Mr. Abadi, and then Ms. Soleil, and then we'll go to Imperial.
Mrs. Franks, on these the years you cut out and stuff like that, these also include the service agreements?
Yes.
And some of the service agreements before had a five-year lifespan, and some now have a three-year lifespan, so a two-year shot is just a snapshot on the effects of those service agreements?
The ones that are cut out were just... how we pull from these different areas. If you can see on the red here, on this cutout right here, is what we were wanting to show, is you see the percentages kind of dropped. The reason why the percentages of non-local versus local dropped was because these were the years that we had these big projects. So these projects are recorded as non-local vendors. And if we didn't do these particular projects, then that's why I just wanted to show you why in these years the percentages had dropped.
Yeah, but that's based on the monetary value of the overall deal.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
And just to keep in mind that these had subcontractors that were local vendors.
Do you see that trend trading now that there seems to be more workforce than there is work? Do you think... there'll be more locals views knowing there's...
We have, fortunately, the way we have the criteria split up, we've had non-local, you know, people come into our valley to try to do business with us. The advantage that we have is because we have our criteria and we give points for our locals, even if an out-of-towner can come in and low bid them, based on our experience and evaluation and our criteria that we give, our locals stand a really good chance, and the majority of the time we'll win that. When they're big like these ones, they're not equipped to, like the El Centro Unit 3 repowering or the Nyland, they're not really equipped to do that big of a project. They don't have the manpower or the all the different requirements, their EPC contracts, their engineer, procure, and design and construct. So... but by utilizing local resources, like example, Kenny right here, this one was the Salt and Sea Internet Connect from Bannister to Midway. The engineering was done through several of our local vendors as well, as a sub.
I understand some of the projects that we don't do day to day. I guess my question would be, do you see any non-local vendors from the past trying to establish residency today?
Kenny has.
Ms. Soleil?
My question was similar to Mr. Abadi's. I was wondering how much the points, how much can they contribute to a local business being able to outbid a non-local business?
The points can be pretty high. It's like I have non-local vendors whining about it all the time because we give preference to our locals. But I, you know, whatever it takes to give my locals in there, They have experience. They have the ability to do the job. They know our environment, and that's why I make sure that when we go out for a solicitation, I ask not only the vendor to submit their background, but theirs of their subs, so that we can look at who they're using and their experience of them. And it's best value for the district and making sure that we've got the right contract.
Yes, it sounds like a good system. How would you, can you give us an example of how you advise local vendors to partner up in order to be able to equip themselves to compete?
Yes. For example, I brought one of our evaluation criterias, and in explaining the criterias for their experience and their knowledge of the local government and our local environment. For example, just on this one, the points for experience was, and this is at 100, so 5 was for the local. The key personnel is 20 points. The experience and technical competency is 15. The geographical limitations is 5. The proposals to do the work, their method, just like an EPC, it's an RFP, so it's not an apple-to-apple comparison. That's 20 points. The knowledge and understanding of our local environment is worth 10 points. Cost is 10, local is 5, and exceptions are 10. So as you can see, they can get 25 to 30 points right off the bat being local because they know this stuff. And so I tell them to attend the job box and the mandatory meetings, even if they say, Lori, I can't do all that big projects. Like, show up, partner up. And then I tell the non-locals, hey, here it is, read it and wait, because if you guys partner up with the locals, you're going to get more points. If not, you know.
Now, you were saying that you cannot discriminate on the base of race, age, color, or any other criteria,
correct,
right? Is there any sort of affirmative action points that are awarded for hiring minorities or anything like that?
The problem was is that I'm going back a little bit. I've been with the district 5 years, but prior to that, I was the director of contracts and purchasing at Imperial Valley College. So for 10 years, I followed the public contract code, and we had to record percentages of the disabled, the veterans, the minorities, yes, the women's groups, and all those percentages. And if we didn't spend our money in that percentages, the next year we lost money. Okay, but Prop 209, because the other businesses were being discriminated against, then Prop 209 came into play, and it was determined it was illegal to discriminate.
Period. So affirmative action points were not
So that, and that was done in 1996. But the funny thing is, so any state funded, you can't ask, but the federal still wants you to ask. So it's kind of like,
you don't know which way to go.
But yes. The Imperial Irrigation District doesn't, you know, follow that parameter. And even if we did, it would be illegal. So I would never encourage that.
Okay.
All right. Are there any questions in Imperial County? No. Okay. Did you want to ask a question? No. Okay. I guess this isn't. Oh, is there one, Mr. Abadi? Did you have another one?
Mrs. Franks, you were saying that if a non-local contractor came in and hired did a little sub out to a local contractor, they would get local the extra 5 points.
No.
Okay.
They would get points in the other categories as far as the experience, knowledge of the local environment and things like that. And we also push them because on our response forms, there's a sheet that says subcontractors. You have to list the percentages of work that they will actually be doing.
Okay, but as long as it's more than 50%, then I guess because I know there's, you know, some of these projects is big and everything may take a certain different piece.
I mean, right.
Like everything in your TV is made in the United States. Okay, so I understand that. I just want to make sure there's firewalls in there that nobody could game this system.
Correct.
Okay.
Is this the way other large utility companies do it? Because this is new to me. In the public sector, we just give a straight 10% preference to local vendors from the contract price instead of a point system.
We used to, prior to changing the policy in 2009, that was an approved change, they used to give 5% only for the local vendors, and they lost a lot of contracts. because the companies would know that and they would just underbid them. And so by this criteria, by enabling other areas to obtain points as well, then it's I don't know about other agencies, but I do know that it's really nice to be able to offer that to our local vendors. And I'm always supporting that, so.
Okay, well, thank you for the update. No one in Imperial is asking to speak or ask any questions on this item. And we are concluding our questions here in La Quinta, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll move on to item number 8, which is the proposed 2012 centralized services budget. And if you could, please, Mr. Hall, remember to just keep the mouth like right up in your cheek and don't move, because I think that's what's causing the lagging and dragging in Imperial.
Sure. Okay, good evening, Ed Hall. Good evening. Today I'm going to be
and the reason I'm bringing it to you now, excuse me, I think we began to experience,
you still have lag?
Yeah, the minute he began to speak, it began. So let's
it's
try
something
again.
At the podium, because you don't hear us lag, right? We are not lagging, it's the podium, correct?
Well, now your voice is beginning to lag. You're cutting in and out.
You might have static from either the return over your head, some kind of
feedback
or something, or just the vibrations of the return.
I think we're okay. Something came up on the screen. I didn't catch it, but it looks like we had a temporary interruption. So let's continue.
We're trying to figure out what's causing the lag or drag at the podium.
It seems like every time they move and a new speaker comes up, it starts that way. And then it starts adjusting.
Maybe adjusting to the audio.
Exactly. Like, yeah, every time a new speaker comes up, that
it's
happens.
Loud and clear
so
now.
Maybe we gotta wait a little bit.
Okay. Okay. Just let me know if it starts again, and I'll try to change position or something.
Thank you.
Anyways, the reason I'm here now rather than later in the year, we've decided to change things a little bit for this year. And rather than bring the entire budget in late October, we thought we would bring the budget in sections as they're completed. And we thought that might make it a little easier to digest. So again, today we're looking at the centralized services budget. Now this budget includes services which provide benefits to most of the district, both energy and water. There are a few areas that are specific to either energy or water, but most of them are split among both departments. And you can see it includes the executive department, the finance department, administrative and support services, which includes general services, information technology, supply chain management, and reliability control, and then human resources. Now, the goal of our centralized services, or the goal of the district with regard to the centralized services budget, is to try and keep it as flat as possible. We don't want to increase our overhead if we can possibly avoid it. And so if you look at the four-year period from 2009 to 2012, we've had an increase of $884,000, which sounds like a lot, but if you look at it, on average, this is less than 0.5% per year since 2009. Now, it's not a continual increase, it's up and down, but that's an average. And I'll show you on the next slide actual figures behind this. Okay, this slide shows you 4 years from 2009 through 2012 budget figures. It also shows you a variance between the 2011 and 2012 budgets, and then in the far right, a percentage change. Now, of the overall increase from 2011 to 2012, which is in this slide, 1,221,000, that increase, the majority of it is in the executive department, and that actually doesn't reflect an increase in cost to the district. What it reflects is a reorganization where we have moved the project management office from energy over into the executive department, and that's the majority of the increase. That's 18 staff under the PMO. Plus, it also includes, let me give you the numbers here.
That, the PMO portion represents $480,000 of that 853 increase. Another major portion is from the addition of the Colorado River Water Division, which is a budget of $359,000 and three employees. So that's what makes up the majority of the increase for 2012. Other increases, you can see there is a potential increase in information technology of $271,000. IT is proposing to add a deputy manager. Also, we can see reductions in the finance department. This is basically it's positions that have not been filled, and a couple of them have been eliminated. And then down in human resources, you can see an increase of $246,000. This is for, I believe, two additional employees in the security and claims area. Now, on the next slide, this breaks down in the same areas. It breaks down the personnel changes or staffing levels. And one thing you need to note here in the executive line, the budgets 2011 and going back to 2009 have been adjusted to reflect PMO's addition to that line item. So in other words, it's been the PMO in those years have been reflected in that line item. So the difference between 2011 and 2012, which shows an increase of three, actually represents mostly the Colorado River Water Division and I believe one administrative staff. And as you can see, if you go at the bottom, total staffing by department, and you compare 2011 to 2012, we've had a net increase of two people. And when you look at the 2011 actual of 3.6, yes.
Can you please speak into the mic? Close, maybe closer.
No. When you turn your head.
Yeah, okay. When you turn your head to address the board, it seems to.
I'll try to angle it a little bit differently.
Much better.
Okay. If you look at the 2011 actual of 346, and then you look at the budget of 367, this represents positions that are budgeted for, but are not necessarily filled or may be filled during the following year. And that's all I have for this presentation. We'll be bringing back this budget again during the final presentation of the entire budget in late October. I believe it's scheduled to go to the board on October 18th. And so you'll have a chance to ask questions again. But if you have questions now, maybe we can address them in our planning process.
So when will we see it again, if it's going to the board October 18th?
Okay, what will happen is this is just the centralized services budget. Next will come the operating budget and the capital budget for both energy and water. And at that time, the centralized services budget, if it has any changes, it will also come back and be part of that packet. And then finally, you will see the complete budget. I believe it's scheduled for October 18th to go to the board. So that would mean I guess that would put it in the November ECAC meeting.
That's what I'm trying to get at. So we're going to see it after the board?
That.
Oh, just for a preliminary presentation?
Yes, for information, not for a vote. Sorry.
For the first draft.
Round. Exactly, the first
round. Okay, so your goal is to bring it to us in pieces, let the board have a presentation on it, and then it comes back to us for us to make recommendations.
Right, before any vote by the board.
Thank you. Do we have any questions here in La Quinta, Mr. Blum?
Yes. If there are changes from the preliminary information that you bring to us and the final information, we may not have this with us. Could it be identified as modifications or variants from what you're presenting to us?
Yes, that is a good idea. Being this this is our first time taking this approach, I think that's a good recommendation that we do that.
And you can do it that
way? Yes.
All right, thank you.
Any other questions here in La Quinta? Are there any questions in Imperial County? Everyone understands the process? Okay, I have nobody responding in Imperial, so I'm going to assume that is, you're good to go.
Okay.
Thank you very much on the presentation.
Thank you.
We appreciate the preview. Moving on to our next item, we have item number 9, the budget subcommittee nominations. Those are nominations made by the chair. There is nothing in the packet on that, right? Currently, the members of the Budget Committee have been carried from year to year to year, rotating the chairmanship, the past chair, out of the committee and importing a new member to represent the area that the past chair went out. So this last year, Mr. Alsup was the chair, and now he's out of the committee. So now it remains Mr. Gil Perez and Mr. Who's the other one? Ortega, Mr. Antonio Ortega, as the two remaining members for Imperial. I am rotating into the chairman's position of this committee. And the other member on the committee was Mr. Blum. So that leaves one vacancy from La Quinta to be filled. Does everyone understand what I'm explaining? Okay, that we just kind of move out the old and bring in the new every year. It provides continuity so that from year to year to year, there is some institutional knowledge left behind, but it does also give an opportunity for a new member to be introduced to the process. And since a lot of the members on this committee are new, I just thought I'd explain that. First of all, I'd like to ask the members from the last year's Budget Committee if they are all willing to continue on this assignment. That would be Mr. Ortega, Mr. Perez, and Mr. Blum. Are you all three willing to continue? Mr. Perez and Mr. Ortega, are you willing to continue on the committee for budget?
This is Antonio. Yes, I am willing to be on the committee once again this year.
Mr. Perez, are you willing to continue on the Budget Committee? From last year,
yes.
You were on it last year,
yes.
Gil? Okay, thank you. Okay, so that leaves one vacancy from the La Quinta side. Are there any members of the La Quinta side that would like to be considered to rotate in? Otherwise, I have to draw names out of a cup. It's usually about 3 meetings and a lot of homework because you have stacks of paper that you take home and review. And then we get together and discuss it. It was about an hour or two, Blum. Mr. Blum, do you remember? Yeah. No, I'm not talking about the homework. We got together one meeting. Staff gave us all the homework. We went home. We came back to the second meeting with our list of questions. We went home. We put together a staff report. And then the third time was the presentation to the full ECAC.
I'm not volunteering to do it yet. I have a question.
Okay.
How are we going to handle the meeting?
They're always like this, conference call.
Okay, then I will volunteer.
Yes, that's how we discovered that it works for us. We did it last year.
Oh, okay, well, I didn't know.
Yeah, we did it last year, and it worked well, Imperial and La Quinta. Okay, so I do have a volunteer? Oh, wonderful, great. Okay, we have our new 5-member committee. And if there be no objection, I'm going to nominate the same committee, adding one more person, and I'm going to rotate into the chairmanship. There being no objection, we're going to move on to item number 10, which is the ECAC attendance report and vacancy. Marion, we have good reports, right?
I actually have good news. Make sure everyone in Imperial can hear me. I have good news. We have one vacancy on the committee currently, and that is the Palm Desert Ranch from Mirage. I have been in contact with the city manager's office in Palm Desert. They have someone that they would like to nominate who does reside within IID service territory. They are in the process of getting that ratified through the city council, and I'll be working in the next couple weeks to also get that ratified through the IID board of directors. So best case scenario, we'd have someone next month. It may take another month, though, because the board meeting is in 2 weeks. So our meeting is in two and a half weeks. So it's a little bit tight on the turnaround.
That's great news, Marion.
Okay.
For those of us that have been here from the beginning of the reconstituted ECAC, that's great news. Thank you, staff, for really working on that.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
Chairwoman? I think there's a correction needed. Becky is listed as her term completed in December 2010, which means she shouldn't be here right now, or she shouldn't have made a motion, so I know that needs to be corrected.
2014, she actually got extended 4 more years.
Yeah. Okay. And other than that, we have some people coming up the end of this year. Mr. Blum, Ms. Gomez, Mr. McNicky, and Mr. Bayard. So you might remind your...
Madam
Chair. Mr. Bayard? Oh, this is 2011. So it's me, Ms. Soleil, and Mr. Perez, and Mr. Alsop, and Mr. Anderson. So we'll start working on those reappointments and confirming that the parties still wish to serve on this one wonderful committee.
Madam Chair, I do see a corrections, actually a couple of corrections. On the upper portion, the last three dates, the years needs to be corrected. And the attendance,
oh,
actually,
yes,
for you and for Mr. Ramos, it says zero. I believe those are supposed to be ones for last month's meeting.
She's saying that the last three headings say 2010. They should say 2011. And then the August 2nd, 2011 meeting shows both Brad and I absent. That was an Imperial, wasn't it?
Yes, that was Imperial.
Oh, that's right. I went with Christy. But you were absent, Brad. It's your fault. The wrong Ramos. Thank
okay,
you. Thank you for calling that to our attention. Thank you. Okay, there's no questions on the attendance report. That's just for information. We're going to move on to item number 11, member comments. And I know we all have lots of wonderful comments to make. So do we want to start here in La Quinta? Does anyone have any comments they'd like to make? Mr. Bayer?
I'm sure most of us, if not all of us, experienced a power outage last week. And I want to commend the staff. We didn't do anything, right? The staff of Imperial Irrigation District for getting many of us back online. I couldn't believe 20 minutes. I was on my way to open my garage door to get out to go help other people. Power came back on, which was a bad thing because I didn't know that there were another 2,000 homes in my development that had no power. So I didn't go out and help them until an hour and a half later when I went to the pool and it was dark. So... it was a great experience, but a bad one, we know. Thank you.
Any other comments here in La Quinta? Mr. Blum?
Kevin, thank you so much for getting having the work finished on Skype. I think it's demonstrated itself tonight that it's a great asset and really a simple, modern way for us to do business on a remote basis and do it successfully. My other comment is welcome to Mr. Ivy. Glad to have you on board. Thank you.
Any other member in La Quinta wish to make comments? Ms. Soleil?
Yes, I'm wondering if at our next meeting we can have a report on the power outage. What caused it? How the nuclear power plant went off and all of that kind of stuff. I think that would be very interesting. I also like to have a report on the backup system operation control center and what progress is being made on that and what the considerations are and where that will be placed. Yes.
Thank you. Joel Ivy for those in Imperial. I've asked Mario Escalera to take the lead, and he's gladly accepted to produce a comprehensive report for internal use. As Mr. Kelly pointed out before, we're also having to report to the federal agencies, to the Western agencies, and we have a person that is flying to the California ISO as we speak to participate in some activity to try to get to the actual root cause and create a true sequence of events that led to the actual power outage. So we should be able to get something like that to you for the next meeting.
And remember, layman's terms, executive summary for some of us.
And things that we want to say in public.
Yes.
Not that we're hiding anything, but I'm saying
understandable.
That there's some information for critical infrastructure and things like that we may want to have sensitive. But other than that, it should be a fairly comprehensive report, I believe.
And about communication between people who had, who were subjected to the outage and how they can get through to IID. I made a suggestion in an email that we have a direct line, direct telephone number. Those of us who serve on community councils our natural people, for those who are experiencing an outage, to ask questions. And we had a 7-hour outage in Thousand Palms. So we had a lot of seniors who were without air conditioning and lots of questions, and we couldn't get a timeline. Hmm. The only person I could communicate with about this was my niece, who lives in Lake Forest. They happened to be having an outage too, which I didn't know. And she said it wasn't going to be resolved until the following day. Well, the electricity came back on at 10:30 that night. But seniors get very concerned. They need to know where to go, what to do, and what the time frame is that they'll have to endure the outage.
That has been, can you hear me in Imperial?
Yes.
Yes. That has been an ongoing problem. An outage occurs typically in the summertime. It's really hot, and people can't get through. In this last event, we recorded 6,500 incoming calls, I think in the 4 hours. We only dropped about 400 of them. This is anecdotal, just what I remember. And that's not a good number, but it represents a great stride from a year ago in the summer. So, and we did have some recorded messages this time that actually offered some, you know, concrete information for people. It's not a perfect system. It's not a dedicated, you know, live person. You have to really work to get to a live person. So we'll be revisiting that, but it's much better, and it'll improve as we go.
Well, we were also hampered by the information being down. 411 was not answering, and all of those things I know have to be worked on. But it'd be interesting to hear what you're doing.
We will do. Our board has asked for a sort of brief update. And I must tell you that all of the accolades that I'm personally receiving for IID's timely response, I'll gladly accept. but I had nothing to do with it except getting the people doing the actual work burritos that night. So I did my bit.
Nice of you to give them the credit.
But I will tell you that 7 million people ended up being affected. And what we have on the record right now is that, you know, an isolated event in Yuma, Arizona, caused all that. And my sense is, and I think it's pretty well-founded, I think Mr. Ivey shares this, that we'll find out that it was more than that.
Yes, yes. So. Okay, thank you.
Any other comments, Ms. Broughton?
I live in about 15 minutes from the edge of the earth, and our power was actually only out for 3 hours, which I thought was amazing. I appreciated the comments that were posted on the web, which I could still access because my notebook still had, you know, battery, as well as my telephone. So I thought it was amazing. I really expected it to be till the next day. So my hats off, my appreciation's there for all of those folks that were out there actually doing the work on that horrible evening. And I do think perhaps there's a way that we could communicate with those persons that are community leaders. Maybe it's a matter of going to presidents of boards or something. One possibility is a text blast to numbers that you've accepted to sign up for. That would be easy. You have your hands full at that point, and you don't need a lot of extra stuff to do. But it's a thought. But from my end of the world, I say thank you. But I hadn't even started worrying about the beer getting warm in the refrigerator.
Mr. Blum?
I did have the benefit of hearing Marion's interview with the media. And I just happened to have have it on and listen to it. But it was very complete. I mean, by the time that interview was over, I knew what was going on and that when and pretty much when we were going to get power on. So I thought that was very well done. But it was just by chance that I happened to turn it on and get the information. But I commend you for the information you put out. I thought IID handled it very well. And I'm glad that one of the things I was delighted about that the Cliff House, even though it's in IID territory, had power that night. So they had a bang-up business with serving all of us that were out of our homes and looking for a place to eat.
Mr. Abadi, did you have any comments?
Thank you. Again, I want to commend the IID on how they accomplished handling the blackout. I guess, you know, it's probably one of the problems that's always been struggling. I know Mr. Kelly's getting information to people. Most of the information, I guess, sources that we have available require some sort of power. So when you have something like this, it's a struggle. I have a question for Mr. Ivy, and by the way, welcome to the IID.
Yeah, what
a- Mr. Ivy, on when you're looking going through, besides just looking at the cause, if there's any load rejection by some of our generators, if things started to trip and perform the way they should, there'll also be a damage assessment to any of our generation equipment?
Absolutely, we're taking a look at all of that. We had some breakers that didn't do what they were supposed to do. We had some generators that were wandering. We had some independent power producers that stayed online that we thought would have dropped offline. So this is a very complex set of events, and we're going to go through and lay out a true sequence of events, what happened and what step, which takes some assuming, some educational guessing going on to get to. But by the end of that, and hopefully that'll be done by the end of the week, as Mr. Kelly mentioned, we should have that much of it laid out so we know actually what happened. And then we can make a determination of did everything perform the way that it was absolutely supposed to. Did we have any underlying damage? We had some things happen that weren't supposed to, mostly, I'll say that. That's equipment that's getting on up there in years, typically. And that's some things that we're going to have to address, certainly. But that will come through in the report that we're going to produce.
Say, for instance, we bought gas for, say, Yucca, real close to the APS area. The gas now got shut down. Could we store the gas? I mean, did we have to take it? Could we shut it down and use it later? Did we get bills for it? The same as the other people that generate and transmit across the lines, now we couldn't transmit. Are they going to send us a bill? Or do we get to send somebody else a bill?
Well, I'll tell you straight up, one of the reasons we were able to get Coachella Valley area back online as fast as we could was because the California ISO reached out to us and said, we've got some power for you if you need it. And we took advantage of that. It was all about getting power restored at that point in time. They will not charge an exorbitant price for power under circumstances like that. It'll be fair under the circumstances. We, in this business, we tend to work together for emergencies and try to minimize the pain because you're going to have to, pay it back at some point in time. So I think all that went pretty well. I'm not aware of any issues with the lines, the pipelines, and things like that being shut down. I know we have Yucca down right now as we speak. We've got cooling tower issues. That's a big deal. We're going to have to look for some more money to replace that, basically. It's a significant expense. But I'm not really aware of anything pipeline related. Had this gone on for a longer period of time or been a broader outage, perhaps, then it very well could have caused some supply issues with the fuel, specifically gas.
Thank you. Mr. Ortega in Imperial County, do you want to call upon your members to see if they have any comments they would like to make?
Yes, I also want to commend the IID for doing a great job restoring the power. I'd also want to commend you guys for setting up this video conferencing. It does make attending these meetings a lot easier, so I appreciate it. Thank you.
Anyone else, Mr. Ortega?
This is Gil Perez. The only thing I'm going to ask everybody is to speak into the microphone, because for those of us a little bit hard of hearing, we can't hear you very well when you're speaking above the microphone. So if you speak into the microphone, I think it'll convey your message a lot better, at least to me. The system seems to be working okay, except that when the speaker's there in the podium, go to speak, they're speaking above the microphone instead of into the microphone, and that makes it very difficult for us to hear, at least on this side. Thank you.
Mr. Ortega, is that it?
No. This was Gil Perez, not Mr. Ortega. I'm sorry.
Oh, no. I know, but Mr. Ortega's co-chairing with me, so I'm asking him to let me know if everyone has completed their comments.
Yes, I think everyone here is done. I also have just want to echo the comments of all the other board members, commending all the staff at IID for the repowering so quickly. For those of us here in Imperial County, I think we were back up and running about 3 hours later, 4 hours. I know that some of y'all in the Coachella Valley took a little bit longer, but nonetheless, I think it shows the amount of improvements that IID and their staff have done to ensure that when things like this happen is when we need them the most. So commend all the staff and also the individuals that are here, IID staff and those that are working with us on the video conferencing. There's some staff here in the joining us here in the El Centro office, and we want to thank them as well for making sure that our system's working today, and it does make a big difference on the driving for those of us and you as well when we go out there. So thank you.
We think this worked out well. We'll work out the bugs as we move forward. I too would like to thank all of Imperial Irrigation District staff. This was a significant experience for us this past week, and I hope that we take note of our victories in what we did well and take note in our shortcomings and where we could have done better. But overall, IID responded expeditiously. They got us all back online. Fortunately, I did have my phone tree in my community. So within 30 minutes, I already knew the window that we had to wait, and it was easier for us to be at peace knowing that IID was on the road in the first 30 minutes. That gave us all great comfort and great peace. And then when the second message came out that it would be on by 1 a.m., again, gave us great peace that we knew IID had everything under control because we could see that this was going to be resolved. Unfortunately, I was the 100th person to come back on because I didn't come back on until 10:45. But I think that really helped me understand the challenges that everyone was experiencing. As a city leader, it certainly gave me pause and areas to take into consideration as I continue to allow developments to come forward. Never before did we stop to think what happens when all the power goes out at 3:30 and the kids can't go home because all the gated community gates won't open. The pedestrian gates won't open. The kids are out in the street not knowing what to do. Their parents are at work and can't call their kids. The dog's locked in the house and needs to be let out to go potty. I'm only giving you these because this is what happened to me. So, it was very scary, but from it, I took a lot of mental notes personally for our side on the city side, and I know Imperial Irrigation did the same. We all need to work through this and stay in communication with each other. I think Facebook was a great outlet. I did receive the texts and Facebook messages, and they were just like 5 or 6 little words, but that was enough. That was like a lifeline. Yeah, they do. Oh, we should all be friends with IID Facebook.
You know, not to belabor the point, but Ms. Champion is the one who introduced the whole social media in the last year, I think, and or last month. Oh, so super timely. But we talked about it for a year. I just don't want to let the occasion pass without saying what a stellar job Marion Champion did as a spokesperson. That's a really tough thing to do, especially long distance. And we had some, especially broadcast outlets, who were really antsy to fill up time, and all they had to do, all they could really talk about, you know, there was no news other than when's the power coming back on.
Yeah.
And she knocked all those down, you know, handled a lot of belligerent reporters. So.
Well, it served us well. We were able to give information in the first 30 minutes. I personally was broadcasting live from the Red Robin in Lakinta. All of the national and regional media was contacting me, but because I had what little information I had, I seemed to bring calm to the community, letting everyone know if they just could stay in their homes, keep the doors shut. You know, if they were cool, they were safe. If they needed to get cool, go to where the power was on, which was 111 in Coachella Valley. So I did give all of the regional media some bits of information that they could disseminate and let people know that it's under control. So I think we did well, and we can improve upon that.
Your point is a good one. Elsewhere, especially, you know, in an urban setting, it's a matter of inconvenience and you know, upset. But here in our service area, you know, if the sun's still out, it's you know, much more urgent. So. You know, I commend Marion, and her reward is that she'll be doing it from now on. So,
thank you, Marion. Thank you, Marion. Okay, if there be no further member comments, our next item is item number 7. Our next meeting is as the regularly scheduled first Monday of October, October 3rd. We will have more information on the budget. Now, it says here El Centro at 6, but that doesn't really matter anymore, does it? Or do you all want us to...
The actual meeting location will be El Centro. That means all of the presenters will be in El Centro at the next meeting. To keep it fair, we will be continuing to go back and forth with the presenters, and I'll be traveling with the presenters.
That's great. Now, how will we handle the chair and co-chair? Will I stay here, or will I have to travel with the show?
We'll talk about that offline.
All right. If there be no further business, thank you, everyone. This worked out well. We will stand adjourned.